In the 1980s, extracorporeal shockwave therapy was first used to disintegrate renal stones. Back then, it was known as extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy. But ever since, shockwave has become a popular therapeutic modality in the field of orthopaedics and traumatology for the treatment of lots of different musculoskeletal disorders. But before we can get into its clinical use, first we have to discuss what shockwaves actually are. Shockwaves are rapid and powerful pressure waves that can move through different mediums like solids, liquids, and gases. They have a measurable effect on the tissues they pass through in that they can cause a variety of biological responses. But when it comes to extracorporeal shockwave therapy in particular, these kinds of shockwaves have a number of characteristics. They are dynamic and exhibit what are known as swift positive pressure impulses, followed by a slight negative pressure phase. The positive and negative phases of shockwaves have certain effects at the crossover points between the different tissues of your body, depending on their different densities. In the positive phase, say, high pressure shockwaves may hit a tissue interface and be reflected, or they may pass through and gradually become absorbed. Then, during the negative phase, which is also referred to as the tensile phase, the shockwave generates cavitation at the tissue interfaces, and this results in the subsequent formation of air bubbles. These air bubbles then implode with high speed, producing a second wave of shockwaves. The upshot of all of this is that this biphasic nature, in theory at least, underpins shockwaves' effects in tissues, promoting healing and regeneration. Essentially, shockwaves interact with tissues like bone, muscle, cartilage, ligament, and tendon, creating mechanical stresses and affecting cellular structures and functions. These interactions and their biological responses are known as mechanotransduction and underpin shockwaves' positive effect on tissue regeneration and wound healing. We'll be talking about mechanotransduction in more detail later. Now, there are two main kinds of extracorporeal shockwave therapy: focused shockwave therapy and radial shockwave therapy. Focused shockwaves can be created in three ways: electrohydraulic, electromagnetic, and piezoelectric. We don't need to delve too much into the technicalities of these methods. The thing that is common to each of these three is that they all use water to generate focused shockwaves. They differ with respect to the moment at which the shockwaves are formed. Electrohydraulic generators, for example, produce shockwaves immediately, whereas the other two have a slight delay of a few nanoseconds before the shockwave is produced. All you need to know, though, is that focused shockwave therapy concentrates the shockwaves at specific depths in tissues, allowing targeted treatment. In contrast, radial shockwave therapy's impact is more superficial, spreading out from the point of application. You see, radial shockwaves are not generated in water. They are generated using compressed air to accelerate a projectile into the applicator head, which itself creates a pressure wave that is then transmitted from the applicator head into the body. When it comes to the parameters of extracorporeal shockwave therapy, energy flux density is the key term to know. It is the thing referred to by professionals and is based on the flow of shockwave energy through an area. Its unit of measurement is given in millijoules per square millimeter. Energy flux density is important because it basically describes the amount of energy being applied to the tissue and results in different treatment effects. Lower and medium energy flux densities, for example, which range from less than 0.08 millijoules per square millimeter to about 0.28 millijoules per square millimeter, trigger the release of nitric oxide, which is beneficial due to its antalgic, angiogenetic, and anti-inflammatory effects, whereas higher energy flux densities of up to about 0.6 millijoules per square millimeter are recommended for the treatment of things like pseudoarthrosis. But before we can understand why these energies are used for these conditions and whether they're actually effective, we first need to understand extracorporeal shockwave therapy's mechanism of action. We need to delve in a little bit more detail into the mechanotransduction phenomenon I mentioned before. Essentially, shockwave's mechanism of action takes the form of a four-step sequence. In the first step, the physical phase, shockwaves are delivered to the body, which creates a realm of positive pressure. This pressure acts like a symphony conductor, guiding energy waves, directing their absorption, reflection, and transmission through the tissues and cells. Then, in the physiochemical phase, the initial physical stimulus leads to a biochemical response. Biomolecules like adenosine triphosphate, or ATP, are released, causing cell signaling pathways to be activated. Next, during the chemical phase, ion channels and cell membranes are altered, and this affects the mobilization of calcium in and out of the cell. And then this all plays out in the last phase, the biological phase, where the angiogenesis, anti-inflammatory, and bone and soft tissue healing effects have all been observed. All of this, the physical phase where shockwaves are applied to tissues, and then the physicochemical, chemical, and ultimately biological responses embody the process of mechanotransduction. In a sentence, mechanotransduction is a cellular process where cells convert mechanical stress into biochemical responses. The foundational concept here is that extracorporeal shockwave therapy causes mechanotransduction, and that this fosters a range of cellular responses, culminating in cell proliferation, vascularization, neuroprotection, chondroprotection, and bone healing. Next, we'll be discussing a more practical question, whether extracorporeal shockwave therapy actually works. In other words, does it improve patients' outcomes? This is a pretty complex question. There are so many possible patient groups, diseases, injuries and conditions, and methods of application that it's unrealistic to expect a simple answer. Rather, what we'll do in the next section is to discuss some of the musculoskeletal conditions for which the most amount of research investigating the use of extracorporeal shockwave therapy has been done. Sticking to secondary research sources, systematic reviews and meta-analyses to keep things manageable. One of the most common conditions that physiotherapists use extracorporeal shockwave therapy for are tendinopathies of the upper and lower limbs, of the Achilles, patellar, gluteal, and rotator cuff tendons, and conditions like plantar fasciitis or plantar fasciopathy. The thing to note here is that shockwave would rarely be administered as the sole treatment intervention. It is usually combined with a structured exercise program, for example, but in any case, results seem to be conflicting. For instance, three systematic reviews with meta-analyses published in 2023 investigated the use of shockwave therapy for the treatment of lower limb tendinopathies. Results were a little unclear. One review suggested there is a lack of evidence for extracorporeal shockwave therapy for improving pain or function when it is combined with exercise. In other words, the treatment effect seems to come solely from exercise. Another review that also performed a network meta-analysis had a similar finding, that extracorporeal shockwave therapy, when combined with exercise, provides little added benefit for pain and function in the long term. However, they did find that extracorporeal shockwave therapy had beneficial short-term effects on pain and function for both Achilles and patellar tendinopathy. There was a caveat to this, though. The estimated effects were small and pooled from low to moderate quality evidence. This meant that the authors recommended that extracorporeal shockwave therapy would not be used as a primary treatment for modulating pain and function outcomes in these conditions, but as an adjunct in context-specific situations with known treatments that can provide a meaningful change to the patient. There was better news for plantar fasciitis. Results showed that extracorporeal shockwave therapy had a large effect in both the short to long term, and this finding was strengthened by the fact that the data were pooled from high-quality evidence. On this basis, the authors recommended that extracorporeal shockwave therapy can be provided as primary treatment for patients with plantar fasciitis. The last review in this group again found limited evidence for the effectiveness of extracorporeal shockwave therapy for treating non-calcific tendinopathies, but showed some promising results for calcific tendinopathies, which is where there is a buildup of calcium phosphate crystals in the tendons. Essentially, extracorporeal shockwave therapy seemed to be better as a sole treatment for calcific rather than non-calcific tendinopathies. When it comes to myofascial pain syndrome and low back pain, two recent systematic reviews with meta-analyses seem to show that extracorporeal shockwave therapy tends to outperform a sham treatment or comparator treatment like ultrasound, but evidence comparing extracorporeal shockwave therapy to a more active form of treatment like a structured exercise program was lacking. So the jury is still out. Finally, we have conditions affecting the skeletal system, like fractures and osteoarthritis. Again, the evidence isn't exactly compelling due to a lack of double-blinded randomized trials or trials comparing an active intervention rather than a placebo or sham treatment. As is often the case, more research needs to be done before we can make definitive conclusions about its effectiveness. But unlike many other electrotherapeutic modalities like ultrasound or TENS, there does seem to be a certain number of conditions that respond favorably to extracorporeal shockwave therapy. This is just a snapshot of the literature, but overall, there does seem to be good evidence for the effectiveness of shockwave in certain populations. This isn't the place to present a thorough overview of all the literature, so if you want to learn more, I'd recommend using PubMed's clinical queries function to find the research you need for the population groups and outcomes you're interested in. I've included a link to this feature in the description below.